The birthplace of Pasadena is the Arroyo Seco, translated from Spanish meaning dry stream bed. Settlers from the Midwest realized early on that California gold wasn't in the mines and in the mountains. It was in the sky, the gold and sunshine. They acquired massive tracts of land adjoining the Arroyo Seco and let the perpetual sunshine, oranges, and gorgeous geography work its magic. Pasadena isn't a Spanish word. It's out of the Chippewa language, meaning gem of the valley. And the gem, the Arroyo Seco, was a jewel topping the crown. The crown was Pasadena, and Pasadena then became known not as the Rose City, but the crown city of the San Gabriel Valley. Long before rich migrants arrived from Indiana, natives and free black ranchers and farmers had settled the eastern rim of the Arroyo. One of the early black ranchers was Robert Owens. He had orange groves, raised sheep, and farmland called Negro Valley. Owens died in 1865 and his daughter inherited the land. At the turn of the century, she donated the land to the city of Pasadena to be developed as a park. South Orange Grove, just off the Arroyo Rim, was known as Millionaire Row, opulent mansions with matching landscapes. Pasadena had become one of the most exclusive addresses in California, extremely prosperous with the wealthiest per capita population in the country. The Colorado Street Bridge with Bose architecture connecting east and west rims of the Arroyo was completed in 1913. And these new wealthy weren't modest about displaying their riches. In grandiose style on New Year's Day, the prestigious Valley Hunt Club, later to be known as the Tournament of Roses Association, adorned their horses and buggies with flowers, especially roses, and paraded down Colorado Street. After the parade, Valley Hunt Club planned to have an English-style fox hunt in the Arroyo Seco, but that didn't go too well. Nor did the Roman-style chariot races, nor the polo matches. But a football game on New Year's Day, not exactly high class, but that one was a winner. The esteemed scientific community was located at Thorpe College, which was renamed California Institute of Technology. Dr. Albert Einstein lent his name and prestige to building Caltech's scientific image and mystique. However, Dr. Einstein was at serious odds with university president Dr. Robert Milligan on his eugenics and race postulations. The California Institute of Technology, Caltech, built the world's largest telescope and placed it in Pasadena's backyard above the Arroyo Seco atop Mount Wilson. Pasadena was braggedly rich and smart. But there was a critical labor shortage. Domestic help. Who was gonna cook and clean all these fabulous mansions? After World War I, starting in 1919, known as the Great Migration, black families by the tens of thousands were leaving the South and headed north and west for better opportunities. Wealthy Pasadenans were aggressively recruiting experienced domestic help, especially from the states of Georgia, Louisiana, and Texas, where highway billboards were plastered with signings promising train fare and lodging for those qualified and settling in Pasadena. Arriving black migrants settled where they dropped their bags across from the train station on Dayton Street, Over the years, that black neighborhood would disappear, with the only evidence that it ever existed is the church, Friendship Baptist, now historical and cultural landmark. The new arrivals would coalesce with the long-established black community in the northwest of Pasadena on the eastern rim of the arroyo, where the residents would refer to it as the village. Sharing the village with black families were the Japanese, who were the superb gardeners for the very wealthy. The restrictive covenant was specific as to where non-Caucasians could reside in Pasadena. In 1921, arriving in Pasadena on a train from Georgia was Mallie Robinson and her five children, Edgar the oldest, then Matthew Mack, Frank, Willa Mae, and the youngest, Jackie. Also in 1921, the Yarbrough and Clipper families would arrive from Texas and Louisiana. These three families first settled as neighbors on Kirkwood Street, solidifying a lifelong relationship. Most of the children inside the village were funneled to Cleveland Elementary School. On the blurred borders of the village, elementary, junior, and senior high schools were integrated. In 1921, John Muir was a junior high school near downtown Pasadena. Eventually, it moved to the northwest rim of the arroyo in the minority village and renamed John Muir High School. Ironically, the namesake, Mr. John Muir, was a famous naturalist and father of the national parks. He believed in white supremacy, beholden to the ideas of eugenics. Who knew or cared who John Muir was? Just another Washington, Teddy Roosevelt, Jackson, Wilson, all names of Pasadena schools, and all the same in their beliefs about humanity and racism. The Arroyo Seco was our backyard growing up in the Northwest Village, hiking from the spillway under the Colorado Bridge all the way to the waterfall 6 miles up the canyon. Those were adventurous times. However, the bridge has become better known as suicide. Why suicide? The 1929 stock market crash and the Great Depression left many millionaires who went to sleep wealthy, waking up the next morning broke. Legend says that so many newly poor folks crowded the bridge that they had to take a number and wait in line. They weighed their option, jump or broke. They thought about being broke. Then they jumped. Over 90 folks between 1929 and 1934 jumped. Suicide bridge. Hiking in our backyard, from the bridge on foot trails, the bridle path, the stream bed, climbing up over the dam to the watershed and Oak Grove Park. Known as the Rocket Boys, in 1936, four sci-fi junkies at Caltech, fascinated by the likes of Jules Verne's novel, From Earth to the Moon, actually tried making rocket fuel and almost blew up the lab at Caltech. These eccentrics actually thought men could fly to the moon. Fearing a catastrophe in the making, now known as the Suicide Squad, Caltech leased 3 acres of land from the city of Pasadena above Devil's Gate Dam in a dry gully known as the Arroyo Seco. Here, the squad could experiment on rocket fuel, fireworks, or whatever. Eventually, it would become known as Jet Propulsion Laboratory, JPL. During the beginning of the Cold War in the 1950s and with Army oversight, JPL was heavily involved in stationary rocket testing in their Royal Seco. The roar of the engines could be heard for miles.
Once, by chance, the rocket blast coincided with the last Friday of the month testing of the air raid sirens. Panic set in as we dove up under our desks, and with JPL most likely a prime target, we was probably gonna get bombed. Damage to the environment eventually forced a halt to the rocket testing in 1958. In time, JPL went back to its first love, moon flight, and in 1969, 30 years after its founding on 3 acres in the Arroyo, men were walking on the moon.
Continuing our backyard hike, we'd reached the campgrounds and on up to Millard Canyon Waterfall. We called that the headwaters to the Arroyo Seco Creek, but actually, you could keep on climbing, eventually reaching Mount Wilson and the observatory. In the 1920s, Pasadena had the wealth, pride, and arrogance to go all in on a concept known as city beautiful, meaning constructing public buildings with beautiful architecture is an investment in the community's future. To build an attractive city is to build a prosperous city. With the public library on the north end of the axis, the City Hall, with its Moorish and Spanish architecture as the centerpiece, styling fountains, gardens, and a fronting plaza. And the Civic Auditorium on the south end of the axis, Pasadena had indeed built a distinguished and beautiful civic center. The Rose Bowl was completed to a horseshoe shape in 1922 and expanded to the familiar bowl shape in 1928. Most of the work digging tunnels was completed by laborers with pick and shovel. Perhaps they should have paid more attention to the native people about dry riverbeds, but they built the dam and thought it could handle the seasonal rains. In 1938, massive rainstorms drenched the LA Basin for days and days. The dam overflowed and the little stream became a raging river, reclaiming its ancient domain, inundating the floor of the Arroyo Seco. Water was gushing through the bowl's north-facing tunnels, and since the bowl was built below grade, water was rising and flooding the playing field. Ticket booths had washed miles down the Arroyo. The stadium superintendent, Bill Nicholas, was yelling at the workers filling sandbags to abandon the site. He was on the phone notifying the city manager of the impending catastrophe. Visions of large chunks of bowl tumbling down the Arroyo. The stadium was lost, its foundation being undermined. But just as suddenly, after many days, the storm subsided. The surging waters veered west, away from the bowl, ensuring that the Rose Bowl would survive. And before the last drops of rain had fallen, hundreds, thousands of men with pick and shovel were digging and building a flood control channel from the Arroyo Seco to the Los Angeles River. Being built simultaneously alongside the channel was the Arroyo Parkway, which would become the Pasadena Freeway. And the kids from Northwest Village, the flood control channel was like a paved bike path for hustling golf balls and exploring our Arroyo Seco backyard. In 1913, Miss Evelyn Brooks would donate the funds to build a swimming pool in the Arroyo Seco Park, and it would be renamed Brookside. The pool was opened on a segregated basis, blacks only allowed to swim one day a week, 3 to 5 p.m. on Tuesdays. Then the pool would be drained and cleaned and refilled. The ban was eventually extended to include Hispanics and Asians and renamed International Day.
My name is Dr. Reginald E. Jamerson. But I wanted to talk a little bit about what Pasadena was like back in the day when the Brookside Swimming Pool, or they used to call it the Swimming Plunge, was closed to black people in the black community except for one day a week.
Before there was a Fannie Lou Hamer, a Stacey Abrams, or a Maxine Waters, there was a Ruby McKnight Williams. She arrived in Pasadena from Kansas as a certified teacher, and she was informed that Pasadena didn't hire black teachers, nor in sales. The only job that a black woman could get in Pasadena at the time was as a domestic. When McKnight was informed about draining and cleaning the swimming pool, she proclaimed loudly, "Outrageous, totally humiliating and disrespectful of a people. The only difference between Pasadena and Mississippi was spelling." She realized in Pasadena she wasn't facing hooded racists waving Confederate flags. No, these were pseudo-scientific proponents of eugenics, the likes of Robert A. Milliken, president of Caltech and founder of the Human Betterment Foundation, Henry E. Huntington, who enthusiastically instituted restrictive covenants, preventing blacks, that would be non-Caucasians, from buying or even living in the San Gabriel Valley. Miss Knight wasn't intimidated. She would engage her adversaries in a decade-long struggle and win.
The 1932 Los Angeles Olympics would have a profound effect on a couple of kids peering from behind the fence at the Los Angeles Coliseum. A kid named Thomas Bradley said he was so mesmerized by the event that when he was elected mayor of Los Angeles, bringing the Olympics back to Los Angeles was the top of his agenda. 11 years after he was elected, in 1984, the Olympics opened in Los Angeles. What was so amazing about the 1932 Olympics was that black athletes, shut out of all other sports, baseball, basketball, tennis, cycling, everything, they were allowed to compete. Black sprinters Eddie Tolan and Ralph Metcalf finished 1-2 in the 100 and 200 meters and graced the top step of the podium. Mack Robinson, peering from behind the same fence as Bradley, saw his future in track, not baseball. He was an excellent baseball player, run, hit for power. Today, he'd be called a five-tool player.
The Chicago White Sox held spring training at Brookside Park in the 1930s, and Mack and the Pepper Street Gang would challenge the major leaguers. So impressed was the White Sox manager that he stated in front of many onlookers, including Mack's sister Willa Mae, quote, "Too bad you're the wrong color. You could start anywhere in the majors." Mack would concentrate on track, setting national junior college records in the 100 and 200 meter sprints and the long jump. He'd achieve his goal also of becoming an Olympian, winning a 200 meter silver medal in the 1936 Berlin Olympics, finishing one stride behind Jesse Owens.
And like Tolan and Metcalf before, Mack would accompany Jesse Owens to the top of the platform.
Mack's success in the Olympics made a profound and deep presence in the Northwest community. Running track became part of the culture that continues to this day. Mack's immediate impression was on his younger brother Jackie, who'd go on to break all of his junior college records while preparing for the 1940 Olympics, in Olympic Games that would never come about because of World War II. In the 1950 movie, The Jackie Robinson Story, in which Jackie plays himself, he's asked a somewhat hostile question by a reporter. "Jackie, I understand that you weren't the best ball player in the Negro Leagues when they picked you to break the color line." Jackie paused. Then he replied to the question, "Not only wasn't I the best ball player in the Negro Leagues, I wasn't the best ball player in my own family. That would have been my brother, Mack."
So on our block, we had Mack Robinson.
And that would be?
And he is the brother of Jackie Robinson. And they had another brother named Edgar.
That's Jackie and Mack's brother?
Yes, it is. And I heard he was jumping over cars, skating and jumping over cars in Pasadena, going down Lincoln Avenue.
You talk about urban legends in Pasadena. Jackie and Mack's older brother, Edgar. My mother used to tell me stories about Edgar getting up bright and early in the morning and roller skating down Kirkwood and heading his way to the beach by hanging on to a bus or the back of a car.
Before there were skateboards and X Games, there was Edgar Robinson. He was well known for his daredevil tricks, jumping over cars and walls and terrifying onlookers. They say city officials even obtained a restraining order preventing him from roller skating on Colorado Boulevard because he frightened the shoppers. Anyway, Edgar and Mack decided to skate to the beach, about 28 miles. Bellflower was one of the small towns on the way and had a 25-mile-an-hour speed limit in this business district. A cop pulled them over and gave them a ticket for speeding. The next day, it was on the front page of the Pasadena Star News. Mack used to say, if there was a street skating event in the 32 Olympics, Edgar would have won the gold medal. Back in the day, no rubber or polyurethane. They were steel wheels on street skates, and you could be heard coming for blocks away. You use a skate key to tighten the skates on your shoes, and you was good to go. No one skated back from the beach. That was a bit uphill. You put the skates over your shoulders, paid a nickel, and hopped on the trolley. In the 1950s, roller derby was big, huge, especially on television. The derby even drew 50,000 fans at Comiskey Park in Chicago. At the time, the only black women seen on TV were actresses as maids or cooks. And then there was Darlene Anderson skating, flying around the track. As for black women in sports, there was Althea Gibson, number one in tennis. But Althea wasn't on television, and Darlene was, and she had a very reverent following. At 17, she was the Jackie Robinson deja vu integrating the roller derby.
As far as the roller derby was concerned, she was the first black woman. She lived on the corner from us.
Hi, I'm Darlene Anderson, and I want to tell you a little something about my athletics. I used to track, play ball, and then some friends said, let's go and join the training school for roller derby. I was told that they were interested in having me go on a professional team. Brooklyn Red Devils.
And this was at age 16?
And this was 16. I knew mom would say no, but I knew dad would say yes, and that's how I ended up in roller derby.
Darlene Anderson was a very important person to us as young people. She was the very first black woman to be on the derby circuit, excuse me, on the derby circuit.
Mack's legacy. Track and field is a rite of passage in the Northwest Village.
And you live next door to another brother athletic family, and that would be the Clippers.
Yes.
But when it came to track, he said, just let me get out there. I can do this. And he did. He wore a funny hat on his head. 20.6 was the national record that was set in El Monte, California in the CIF finals. In the state, it was the 20.7 which broke Jesse Owens' record.
For high school.
For the state high school. Mm. So.
River.
And it was all these folks
on one
with a few houses of each other.
Yes.
You had this.
Yes. Yes.
Well, what happened to me?
Fred Shaw led Muir to a state championship in 1974. Jerry Proctor led Muir to a state championship in 1967. Charles Mayfield set a national high school triple jump record in 1980 that still remains today. Obie Moore leads Muir to three state championships in track and field, 1994, 95, and 96.
Girls track and field was not competed in California until 1974. Alice Brown, Muir class of 1979, won gold medals in the 1984 and 1988 Olympics, both in the 4x1 relays. Inger Miller, Muir class of 1990, was California state team champion in 1989 and won Olympic gold in 1996 in the 4x1 relay and silver medal in the 100 meters.
Jane Sanford, whose track DNA is from the village, won two golds and a silver to lead Pasadena High School to a state championship in 1977. At assemblies at Washington Junior High in Muir, we crowded into the auditorium to hear Bobby Hutcherson vibe, Herbie Lewis on bass, and Nathaniel Brown on piano. They were playing something called bebop jazz. We didn't understand what it was, but we knew we liked it.
I remember at Washington Junior High going to assemblies and seeing Bobby and...
Oh, Bobby Hutcherson, he's on this album, The Procrastinator, by Lee Morgan. And man, can he play them vibes? Now, I remember him back in Pasadena. He used to play with a good friend of mine's brother, John Lewis. Herbie Lewis was the one, the bass player. Bobby Hutcherson, the vibe man, Pasadena guy, real melodic playing guy, you know?
Bobby lived right on the Arroyo Rim, and his group often rehearsed in his garage. Neighbors and friends gathered on the sidewalks listening to the sounds of hard bop jazz as it waffled down the hills serenading the Arroyo. When Bobby returned home from a world tour promoting his popular album San Francisco, the village turned out to overflowing to welcome home the Vibe Man.
In high school, kind of from a distance, but knew of her as being very quiet and kind of to herself. I ran into her a few times at the La Pinaresca Library, she was, and I bought a book, her book, and read it, and was very impressed. So I'm honored to be honoring her as a member of John Muir High School Mustangs class of 1965.
Octavia Butler, an incredible author who was raised in Pasadena. I think she went to John Muir High School. I like to talk about Moses' Parable of the Sower. It's a book that many years back when I taught literature, I taught this book to my students. And one of the reasons why is because she must have done some incredible research. Octavia Butler had an incredible imagination, and the kind of science fiction that we're mostly used to, I think she just took parts of it and put it in her stories just to propel it into areas that I guess you could not get to in most writing.
Octavia Butler's body of work is archived at the Huntington Library and Art Museum. World War II, a catalyst for change in racial attitudes. The catastrophe that was World War II, genocide of a people based on racist theories that were universally reviled. Members of Dr. Milliken's Human Betterment Foundation stumbled over each other as they fled from the organization. Eugenics and Nazism are fruit from the same tree. And as they fled, you heard another phrase enter the lexicon of our speech. I'm not a racist. In the 1930s, Dr. Albert Einstein had worked with Dr. Milliken at Caltech. In 1946, while lecturing at Lincoln University, the nation's first historically black university and college, Einstein addressed the subject of race. Quote, "The separation of races is not a disease of colored people. It is a disease of white people, and I do not intend to be quiet about it." In 1947, Jackie Robinson integrates Major League Baseball. The city of Pasadena is in court to keep Brookside swimming pools segregated. The city is ordered to integrate the pools, which is a victory for the community and for Miss Ruby McKnight Williams. America fought Nazism in World War II with a segregated armed services. But post-World War II, America wore the mantle of leader of the free world, fighting red tyranny. But racism is a worse tyranny. Segregation made America's foreign policy look very hypocritical. In 1948, President Harry S. Truman issued Executive Order 9981, desegregating the United States Armed Services. Hiking through the Arroyo Seco today. An ugly fence is being installed across the Colorado Bridge as suicide prevention. The channel still protects the Rose Bowl from flooding, and you can still get a bike down there. The old Brookside Plunge is now the Rose Bowl Aquatic Center, used mostly for swimming lessons, swim team practice, and diving. The 10-meter board still remains. The massive numbers of backyard swimming pools with grills and cocktails has made parties at a public pool less attractive. JPL has added the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, NASA, to its title. Remember the Rocket Boys? JPL is now a little city in the Arroyo Seco and no longer is testing rocket engines like days of old. Now it transmits images from deep space captured by the Hubble telescope. The TMT or the 30-meter telescope will be coming online soon. JPL is also flying helicopters on Mars. The Rose Bowl has compiled a most impressive resume. Annual New Year's Day game, college championship, UCLA home field, 5 Super Bowls, Olympic gold medal game in soccer in 1984, World Cup 1994, Women's World Cup 1999, and huge crowds for music tours and events. The Tournament of Roses has added more color and swag. Two of the 4 black queens of the Tournament of Roses, Drew Washington, 2012, and Madison Triplett, 2015.
Once snubbed and ignored, the legacies of Mack and Jackie are now remembered and honored in the city of Pasadena. Today it could be said Jackie Robinson is Pasadena's favorite son. The bronze of Jackie fronts the Rose Bowl, now UCLA's home field, where Jackie was an All-American. Robinson Park is named for both Jackie and Mack. The park where the White Sox used to hold their spring training is now Jackie Robinson Memorial Field. The field at Pasadena City College, where Jackie and Mack both set national junior college track and field records, is now known as Robinson Stadium. The United States Post Office Distribution Center in Pasadena is named for Mack Robinson. The 9-foot bus of both Jackie and Mack are installed across from the Pasadena City Hall on Centennial Plaza.
Pasadena is a great place to I think, be born, raised, and I cherish the experience that I was lucky enough to have.